Michael is the CEO of CIPS, Cambium Indigenous Professional Services. Michael is a member of the Curve Lake First Nations and brings a unique leadership profile to the CIPS teams. Michael is, his specialty is management consulting and community engagement for First Nation communities and projects. Michael's worked on multiple energy projects, as well as projects in health, economic development, infrastructure development, governance, housing, and environmental stewardship. Michael's unique ability to translate the needs of all stakeholders into a language that is understood and relevant to a variety of audiences ensures that communications and information exchanges have value to all participants. And that is exactly the reason that we've asked Michael to moderate this first panel. And if we're all set up.
Chris, how are you today?
I'm good, thanks. And sorry, I just noticed that we got the poll results while we're waiting to introduce you or for you to get your panel started. And just noticed that interesting that almost 30% of people joining us today are from civil society, which we define as the charitable or not-for-profit sector, and academia. But we have a good mix of other people here as well. So, you know, as an NGO, this is a particularly issue, an important issue for us. We know that others like us are struggling with these issues. And so it's glad to see so many of you here and that we can have an opportunity to learn from each other. And sorry about that, Michael, let me turn it over to you.
No problem. Thank you very much, Chris. If I can ask our panelists just to put on their camera for now and so that we can see everyone. Travis, I really enjoyed your opening words as well. Thank you for those. Really excited to be here today and talk about equitable access to clean environment. I'm sorry if I look down a bit. Zoom is a different beast where generally I would be overlooking a crowd of smiling faces. And I will be looking down at my notes and these sort of things as I go today, as I try and moderate four fantastic panelists. I'm super excited to be a part of this. One of them I know very well, Kerry Ann and I work together. The others I've been getting to know over the last 4 or 5 days, and there is some brilliance here on your panel, so I am very excited to look at that. A little bit of housekeeping. Please note that Mariana and Melissa from Pollution Probe are also helping us out with this panel. You may get the odd question sort of pop up from them, and please don't be alarmed when they jump in. They're supposed to be there. And we've invited and been very happy that they're here helping us out today. So if there is a technical issue or we do bump into something, we'll be looking for that. I've seen a couple of the chats come up. Hello from Eric and from Quest and Paul from, I think, Ontario Wastewater are here. Good to see some faces, even though I can't see them. It's good to know that you're out there and that our colleagues are still participating and moving forward. So with that, you'd want to hear less from me and more from the panelists for sure. As we move on. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly introduce the panelists. They'll have about a minute to sort of speak to you and just introduce themselves. I'm not going to do the long introductions. Some of the credentials here are so incredible, it will take a while. So what I'm going to do is just introduce, they'll speak to themselves, speak about themselves for a sec and why they're excited to be here. And then we'll move into a more in-depth panel discussion. The first panelist we have is Dr. Anna Banerji. She's the faculty lead at the Indigenous and Refugee Health, post-MD education, the Faculty of Medicine, University of Toronto. Welcome, Anna. Oh, you're on mute there, Anna. Anna, sorry.
I want to thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me to this panel. I'm actually a physician. I'm not an environmentalist other than in my personal life, but it's important to me to see how, you know, all of this is interconnected, whether you're a physician or a lawyer or an environmentalist, it's one planet and we all have something to share. So thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Anna. And our second panelist is Dr. Heather Castleden. She's the Canada Research Chair in Reconciling Relations for Health, Environments and Communities from Queen's University. Heather and I haven't had the chance to actually face-to-face on Zoom, but if you want to take yourself off mute there, Heather.
Thanks very much, Michael. And thank you to Pollution Probe for the invitation to speak to everybody today. I'm calling in from Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee territory in Cataraqui or Kingston, Ontario. And as Michael mentioned, I'm a researcher at Queen's University. I'm in the Department of Geography and Planning. And most days I identify as a geographer, but generally I do community-based participatory research in partnership with Indigenous peoples across what we now call Canada. And have a lot of my learning has come from Nuchalnith on the West Coast, Mi'kmaq on the East Coast, and in the last 6 years, a lot from Anishinaabe and Haudenosaunee peoples about the way in which we relate to the land, water, and air around us. So I'm going to share some of that and my perspective on questions of equity. So thank you for having me.
Thank you very much, Heather. That's very, very good, and nice to meet you face to face as well. And I hope the participants are going to enjoy your set. Anna Gonzalez Guerrero is the co-founder and managing director of the Youth Climate Lab. And Anna, if you could unmute your microphone.
Hi, folks. My name is Anna, at the other Anna in the panel, the core founder and co-founder at Youth Climate Lab. And I'll be speaking a bit more about kind of the work that I have the privilege to do with young folks across Canada and across the world on empowering young people to take action on climate in ways that are conscious and aware of the climate justice lens that we need to bring into this work. More in a second. Thanks.
Very nice. Thank you very much. And again, Kerry Ann Charles is the Environment Partnership Coordinator at CIPS, Cambium Indigenous Professional Services. I know her well, and I've heard her speak a number of times. So Kerry Ann, why don't you introduce yourself as well?
Anine Bojo, Kerry Ann Charles, Dishnikaj, Georgina Island, Dunjaba, Mayingan Dorum, Anishinaabekwe, Indau. Good afternoon, everybody. As Mike said, I am part of the CIPS team, and I'm really happy to be here. I am a member of the Chippewas of Georgina Island First Nation, where I worked for many, many years wearing many, many hats. So I have a pretty good perspective on community needs within my own community, but then also relate to some of the needs and inequities that go across the board for Indigenous communities in Ontario and across Canada and actually around the world. So I'm really excited to be able to participate in this panel and sort of speak a little bit on that. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you very much, everyone. So what we're going to do is everyone's got a perspective to go from. Again, I'm not going to speak too much. We're going to start with Dr. Anna Banerji. Banerji, sorry about that. She's going to talk about health as a human right and discuss water and food insecurity and contamination and the impact on health. So if you could go ahead and introduce us to that topic, please, Dr. Anna.
Okay, thank you very much. So in 1948, the world came together and created the UN Declaration of Human Rights. And basically they said, health is a human right. And I don't know if you have the slide. Sava?
Okay. If we could get the slide put up, please.
So basically this is paraphrasing the UN Declaration, and a lot of what it says is human rights, equal access to healthcare, equitable distribution of food, safe drinking water and sanitation, adequate standard of living and adequate housing, and the right to a safe and healthy environment. And I would say to you that we are failing our Indigenous peoples. You know, I'm just going to give a few examples. You know, I only have a few minutes, but one of the basic human rights for all people is really the right to have access to clean water. Today, as it stands, there are over 50 First Nations communities that have access to, that don't have access to clean drinking water or under boil water advisories. Without access to clean water, it impacts health in multiple levels. You can have skin infections, you can have gastrointestinal infections, parasites, and there are numerous other health issues, plus the labor and effort it takes to boil water and transport water from wherever it's coming from, the lake, the river, or from buying water. It's very it's very demanding. Now, we're currently right now, I have to say though, it used to be 170 a few years ago, so the numbers are coming down, but we still have some communities, for example, Nishkandika, where the entire community has been relocated. This is in the middle of a pandemic, They didn't have access to clean water. But this has been going on for over 25 years. Every day that Indigenous peoples don't have access to clean water is another day where human rights for Indigenous peoples are being violated. Another example is the mercury toxicity in the 1970s when a pulp and paper mill dumped waste containing mercury into the water system that was downstream, that was upstream from Grassy Narrows. And so the whole community was poisoned. People had acute mercury toxicity, including severe neurological damage, as well as chronic toxicity. This included people being paralyzed, children having brain damage, and many people have died because of the mercury toxicity, including recently in 2018, Grassy Narrows chief Steve Fobister died at the age of 66. If they put up a dam near where I live in Hyde Park and that flooded some of the areas, the houses around there. I think many people are from the GTA, you know it, that's probably the Swansea area. I bet you that that mercury toxicity would have been cleaned up in, you know, in a few days or as soon as feasible. The other issue is, the other example is really food insecurity, which is a major health issue for Indigenous communities. Traditional foods are gathered from the land, include fish, marine and land animals, plants that have been gathered from the local environment. And this has been the mainstay for many Indigenous communities for thousands of years. And as part of the healthy diet for many Indigenous communities, because store-bought food is very expensive. You know, currently we have considerable toxicities in the food chain, including PCB, mercury, which can make the traditional foods unsafe. Changes to the environment have also have impacted migratory routes for many animals, for example, caribou, moose, and again, that affects food security. Indigenous communities have severe levels of food insecurity, depending on the community. For example, in Nunavut, 70% of preschool children have food insecurity. Some of them don't eat for a whole day. In some communities in the Arctic, the food insecurity is so secure that if, when you compare the food insecure homes to the food secure homes, there's a difference of 2 centimeters. That the term for that is called stunting, and that's a global health term. And yet we have stunting occurring in Canada. What does this all mean? You know, when children and other Indigenous peoples see how their basic human rights are not being met, and that other Canadians don't have to think about access to clean water, food and security, what does it tell them? It tells them that their lives don't matter. The lack of recognition of their basic health needs, food, water, impacts the mental health of many Indigenous peoples, especially youth. Indigenous youth, especially Inuit youth, have among some of the highest rates of suicide in the world. You know, again, a lot of this would never be tolerated in our communities. If there were, for example, the Hyde Park situation, there was mercury toxicity in the water, it would be cleaned up right away. If there was any non-Indigenous community that didn't have access to clean water, it would be fixed, you know, as soon as possible, not 25 years waiting. Why isn't this happening? It's a legacy of colonization, which basically says that the lives of Indigenous peoples are less valuable than the lives of non-Indigenous peoples. It's basically systematic discrimination, systematic racism. Every day that we allow these discrepancies to occur and to continue is another day of human rights violations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very, very passionate, very true. From Curve Lake, we see that some of these systemic issues as well. Our next speaker is Dr. Heather Castleden. If you can turn on your mic and you're mute, unmute, then we'd love to hear from you, Dr. Castleden.
All right. Thanks, Michael. Please call me Heather. And I just wanted to say that everything Anna said, I would just say ditto. A lot of her remarks overlap what I wanted to share as well today. And I was going to speak on a global scale first, just to say that, you know, studies that have looked at environmental inequities among countries and what are the implications for the natural environment? We can see clearly that wealthier countries, primarily in the global north, with their strong economic status and geopolitical power, as well as their thirst for capitalistic consumerism, exploit and extract natural resources more than they have available in their own context. And so they also outsource extraction, production, and the related pollution produced through these processes, often to the global south. And then when you look within countries, the relationship between socioeconomic status, racialized identities, and unequal exposure to environmental contaminants has also been extensively studied. And we heard Anna speak to that as well. In the literature, we see this being referred to as environmental racism and environmental justice, and that's been a term coined from the 80s onwards. And Anna referred to Grassy Narrows, and I was going to mention Grassy Narrows as well, with the mercury pollution from that local bleach producing factory. Also on the East Coast, a community I've worked with for 10 years, Pictou-Lanning First Nation, and the carcinogens from a local pulp and paper mill that had been contaminating them for 50 years. Adjawanamang First Nation and its proximity to Chemical Valley in Sarnia. These are all just a few of the communities that are affected. And it's not just Indigenous communities, it's also communities of color, communities where there's low socioeconomic status, where we now know through, and this is a geographical perspective, we know where these things are taking place, environmentally racist decision-making about where things go and who gets the brunt of the impacts. And the field is looking at how and why different groups in society are exposed and harmed by pollution and other environmental risk factors. But now we need to focus on how do we act, because the data show conclusively that economic, social, and health inequities exist, and we need to focus on addressing the systems and structures that perpetuate these inequities. We heard from Anna speak about structural racism and colonialism. And so I guess my main message here is that when natural resources are overexploited, those who depend on them for not only their livelihood, but also their cultural identity, their relational accountability to each other and the land, and their health and well-being are inequitably affected. And the same can be said about the inequitable felt impacts of climate change. And ways that we can address these inequities, I guess what we know is that there's many different approaches and only some of them are working. So taking an intersectional approach to policymaking is one way. But I think taking an intersectional approach to our governance structure is likely to have a more robust, meaningful impact. And I know that Chris, in his opening remarks, talked about that at last year's gala and recognizing the need to do some of that work around diversifying pollution probe and recognizing that it's been difficult to do so. And part of that has to do with what intersectionality is all about. It's about combating heteropatriarchy, feminist hierarchy, hegemony, and exclusivity. All of these things exist in our current regime. And so intersectionality is how we see the world. It's constituted by mutually reinforcing vectors of race, gender, class, and sexuality. And we can acknowledge Kimberly Crenshaw, Black legal scholar who brought this into our consciousness. But beyond that, I wanted to also talk a little bit about the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, because I see that as another tool in order to combat settler colonialism and capitalist colonialism, which are underlying causes of the inequities that we see here in Canada. And while the United Nations Declaration focuses primarily only on Indigenous peoples, I think a lot of the articles in that declaration, and I'll bring up a slide on my next round to speak to those and how the articles can be applied to other marginalized and racialized communities. So in the interest of keeping to my 5 minutes, that's all you get from me, but I had so much more to say. Maybe next round. Thank you.
It won't be the last time we hear from you today on the panel, for sure. And thank you for that insight. If we can go to Anna Gonzalez Guerrero, can you give us 5 minutes of brilliance?
Sorry, I can try. Just trying to coordinate different screens over here. So for the next 5 minutes, I just wanted to maybe reintroduce myself a little bit with more time now and speak to some of the experiences that I've had and a bit of a story here. So my name is Ana Gonzalez Guerrero. As mentioned, I work for Youth Climate Lab. We're a youth for youth nonprofit headquartered in the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin and Anishinaabe people, right now currently known as Ottawa. And I wanted to share something that I actually learned from Larissa Crawford, who you're recognizing in a bit. In one of the many collaborations that we've had with her, she shared that when given the opportunity to do a speech, to do land acknowledgements, to really spend the same amount of time writing your land acknowledgement than you do with the rest of the speech. So I took that a few years ago and have been trying to apply that to some of the work that we do. So when I was doing the remarks for this particular panel, I went back to some of the questions in this tweet that I'm showing. As a non-Indigenous person like myself, I wanted to start to describe the relationship I have with the land and how my family, myself came here, and what I gained and what I lost. So with this context, and bear with me, this is gonna seem like a really long-winded introduction, but it makes sense. I wanted to situate myself for you folks in what we call an intersection of identities. I hold many identities, as we all do. But I think it is worth noting because it has shaped a lot of my experience and my work. So I am Mexican. I was born and raised to Mexican parents. I'm white. I'm privileged in many aspects. The world caters to my able-bodiedness. My socioeconomic status allowed me to learn English as a second language at a young age and be able to pursue an undergraduate degree in Canada to focus on environmental issues. Because at a young age, I got to witness kind of the disproportionate effects that climate change had in populations that were already made vulnerable. So this is where my story collides with the topic of the presentation. But essentially in 2005, Hurricane Wilma hit Cancun, Mexico, where I was living at the time. And what I got to witness was the immediate mobilization of resources going immediately to hotels, what we call the hotel zone. And to tourists to ensure that guests in that territory were not suffering from any lack of water to access, lack of energy, lack of anything. It was really protected towards them. What I got to see on the other side where I lived in kind of the downtown area of Cancun was the exact opposite. The national and some international resources being deployed were exclusively around the hotel zone, and communities in regiones, which are poorer areas of our state, went without water and electricity for months. A lot of these communities from Mayan, the indigenous population that's mostly prevalent in that region. And I think that was the first time that I got to understand, maybe not at that point, but that I got to see the different approach that we take to climate change depending on many other identities and factors that play into the conversation. Long story short, while I was doing my kind of like trying to map what I was going to talk about today, it did not get lost to me the irony that what brought me to Canada was this feeling of anger and disappointment in how resources were being deployed for guests and for people with already a level of privilege, whereas we were not paying attention to people in the communities that needed that attention the most at that time. So I think for the next couple of minutes, instead of talking about some of the work that we do, which I'll get to in a second, or you can visit our website, I would rather bring to your attention some of the youth voices that should be heard from our own backyard. So this was brought up by Dr. Anna, but I think it's worth recognizing that there are still over 60 communities under long-term drinking water advisories in Canada in 2020. And just a few weeks ago, Trudeau failed to recommit to ending all on-reserve boil water advisories by 2021. More specifically, I wanted to bring up same example, but from the youth perspective. These are tweets from the chief of the First Nation, Chris Munias, and these are images of what young people in those communities are asking for, which is access to clean water. I won't get too into the details because some of those were already discussed. There's some alignment in our presentations, but I think I do want to post to the chat kind of this video. I don't think I'll have enough time to play it, but these are the youth voices that should be amplified at this point and not necessarily mine or other privileged voices that have space. But right now I do hold your attention and your access. So I'm going to share this in the chat now. And yeah, happy to get into more of the work that we do in the next set of presentations.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And do look for that link in the chat. It will be posted throughout, and there are networking opportunities for the conference and a number of other ways to get in touch. Kerry Ann Charles, go for it.
Thanks, Mike. So as I mentioned in my introduction, my name is Kerry Ann, and I'm from the Chippewas of Georgina Island First Nation, where I've grown up, been able to live and work in my own community. So a lot of the things that the other panelists have mentioned, I've actually experienced. And it's really quite baffling to me, I guess, to say that because we are in 2020. So to see the inequities in with my own eyes and actually live it is really quite disappointing in terms of humanity, really. So I am on the traditional territories of the Williams Treaty First Nation. That's where I'm presenting to you from, which is my community's territory. And I am privileged to live within Lake Simcoe. Like I said, I'm from Georgina Island, which is an actual island in Lake Simcoe, which is a beautiful watershed. And there's a few things going on there. One, our community has been one of those communities that have been under the boil water advisory for many, many years. We just recently got funding a couple of years ago to update our water treatment plant, which is will allow us to be off the boil water advisory. It is up and running, but our boil water advisory has not yet been taken off because we are still in the process of training staff to run it appropriately. But on the other hand, we are actually fighting to keep our source water protected, which we use to drink in our community. Because of development, because of not having the opportunity for our community members to voice our opinions in implementing what they're calling the Upper York Sewage Solution Project, which will accommodate new growth for York Region. So that's really been a battle for our community for probably the last 10 years. And really what we're battling there is to have our voices heard about what our connection is to that water and what we think and know in our hearts will happen if this treatment plant is actually commissioned and it is allowed then to service the York Region population, the new growth, and then dump 40 to 80 million liters of treated water into Lake Simcoe, which is really not just a body of water to us, but is a part of us and our community. So, you know, it's really, again, like I said, hard to believe the ignorance and arrogance in this day and age about the people that are the first people of this this land that we call Turtle Island, and our voices are still not being heard, and these inequities are still sort of really plaguing us. You know, we talked that there was a panelist that talked about the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, you know, which actually gives us our rights. But also there's the Truth and Reconciliation calls to action and all of that occurred. But I think one of the biggest issues with these documents and these policies is that there's a lot of words written, but not a whole lot of action that is really being taken place. And we need to be able to really start to provide those spaces for the Indigenous voices, but in a meaningful way. We talk about diversity, but you know, a lot of the times, a lot of these organizations that are talking about diversity and talking about making space really don't make enough space for our people to be able to have those voices. And then when they do, we're often looked at as token, and our voices aren't being meaningfully heard and listened to, and then meaningfully incorporated into policies and procedures and you know, the future of our world as a whole. So I think my time is up for that. So I will stop there.
Not bad. Thank you very much on timing. Everyone's done quite well on timing. Just so you know, we're from the script, we're a little bit long, but we're doing fine. So I think what we'll do now is if we could have the panelists turn on their both their sound and their video for a second, and we'll just have a quick little round table. Does anyone want to sort of speak to someone else's, or, you know, there's a lot of common threads here, but does anyone want to just jump in with a comment or two? Someone's got to put up their hand from the panel. Who wants to have a quick chat about what's going on?
I'll start, Mike. Okay. Actually, I just wanted to say, Anna, I love the work that you're doing, and I really like the way that you framed it in terms of what's going on here on this panel today. So I think it's something that's very, very important. And as I reflected on my life, when I left my community and my position and went to go work with Mike, I've realized the amount of youth that I've worked with over the years and in all of the different capacities that I was able to work with in my community. And that it's so important to get them involved and have their voice, because of the fact that this is not what we're doing for us, but it is actually for them. So we need to be able to hear them.
I would echo Kerry Ann's sentiments towards Anna about the youth perspective, but also your point about taking up space. And it was one of the things that I considered with the invitation to speak on today's panel as a white settler scholar, and asking the organizers, are you ensuring strong Indigenous voice, but also Black voices and people of color, LGBTQ two-spirit plus voices, because it's so important that I don't take up a lot of space right now. And when I do, to use the privilege that I have because of settler colonialism to advocate, to work in allyship and accompliceship with Indigenous peoples, particularly because that's the area that I work in. So just wanted to acknowledge that too.
Thanks, I appreciate that. I've gone through the same exercise, and this is something that we've questioned and challenged before joining a panel. And I think there's a lot to actually be able to practice allyship in a way that's meaningful and that is elevating other voices. If I do currently have access and ended up in this panel, thank you for the invitation, but what can I do with that time? And I think that was part of it. And to Kerry Ann's point, I think something that I was noticing and was going to bring up, and I think ties in well with what you're saying, is seeing other groups, in my case, youth, I'm speaking about youth, but partners, allies, as implementer partners, not as a stakeholder to consult or not as another checkbox to mark off in the process of doing my work the way that I'm used to doing my work. But really, how can we engage youth? Again, I'll speak on that experience. In a meaningful way to become partners in decision-making that's gonna be affecting our lives, not just in the future anymore, but now, like tomorrow. And I think that comes back to power, which is another thread that I wanted to bring up. I think we all have to be more willing to, not all actually, settler colonials need to be more willing to give up power and the power that we hold and the access that we hold, and recognize that that's going to come at a cost and it's not going to look as pretty and as exciting as we want it to, but it's needed and it's important work that has to be happening right now if we actually want to be advancing towards a more equitable climate space. And I think we're talking about it, but I don't think I am seeing all that could be in that space.
I just wanted to put a plug in for the Indigenous Health Conference, where our theme is the youth suicide prevention, but also how we mentor the youth to be future leaders. When we're coming back to a lot of these issues and colonization and the disparities, you know, I've often thought that one of the ways of addressing this is really through laws, where you know, you say that it's illegal for any community in Canada not to have access to clean water. And you have that as a law, and you have to make sure that every community in Canada has access to clean water, food security, housing, to make sure that, you know, that it should be illegal for someone to live in a dilapidated garage in the middle of winter at minus 40. And there should be laws that make sure that every step of the way that all governments and individuals and communities need to make sure to ensure that there are basic minimum, and whatever the cost is that goes into making sure that people are protected, and that's the cost. It shouldn't be, okay, we're going to give X amount of dollars, this amount of dollars for an Indigenous community, and you figure it out. It's like, no, this is the level. This is what all Canadians expect as a standard, and let's put enough money to get, you know, that water system to this level, or that housing system to that level, or to clean up the mercury contamination, etc. And that's how we, you know, one of the ways we strive towards equity.
Very good, everyone. It becomes quite obvious that these inequities exist, right? It's until we sort of get punched in the nose, I've been told, punched in the nose with it a couple times, that, you know, it is real in Canada, and it is something that happens in Canada, that we can go on pretty comfortably in the country, but deep down there's something a little bit more. I'd like to ask, everyone can sort of pop off the, close your cameras now, except for Dr. Anna. I'm going to pose a question to you quickly. What are some of the key ways to more effectively ensure access to a clean or healthy environment for marginalized communities?
I think, as I was saying before, I think really we need to have certain laws that have minimum standards for food, water, you know, the environment, and make sure, like right now we have one set of laws and charters for one group of people, and for Indigenous peoples, it seems like, you know, those rules or laws or thresholds don't count. And I think whatever is good for the standard population should be, you know, similar to for Indigenous communities, like, you know, taking into consideration all of their different, all the different aspects in their community. But I think that, you know, I think for every situation we say, for the non-Indigenous people should say, is that okay for me to be in that situation? And if it's not okay for me or my family to live like that, then it needs to change. So I think it's increasing the awareness of the disparities, but also making sure that there are basic standards that every single Canadian, whether you're Indigenous or not, are met. And right now, because there's such a huge gap, it means putting in the money and the resources and to bring it up to par, and for organizations or governments that don't, that there are consequences.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Heather, if I can get you to pop on the screen now, how would you follow up to that idea, and to those inequities, right? We're talking about inequities today. How do we follow that up on from a scholarly, as you've said as well?
Yeah. Well, one of the things that we hear a lot about is, oh, we need more data. And as a researcher, you know, you would think that would be my response too, but I actually think we have lots of data. And do we really need more granular data in order to act? And I think that's kind of what Anna was speaking to, Anna from the Youth Lab earlier. And I looked at this issue in the context of hydraulic fracturing or fracking. And it didn't matter what side of the debate participants in a national Delphi study were on, they all called for more data. But it was actually a call for more data that would support their arguments, either for or against fracking. So at some point, we just have to move on the data we have and respond to the recommendations on the table. And I think also about a couple of really well-known scholars in my field anyway, Eve Tuck and Wayne Yang, who have asserted that for far too long, our focus in research has been on pain narratives in research on marginalized communities who are disproportionately affected by environmental issues like pollution and climate change. And if more research is needed, it should actually be in the area of desire-based, that is research with, by, or for the communities who are most affected. How do they see their future and working towards that? And at the same time, I think our research needs to flip the script and not look at the end result necessarily of human-induced environmental issues like pollution and climate change, but look at the upstream reasons for why these issues exist, because ultimately they exist, as I said before, about because of settler colonialism and colonial capitalism. And by that, I mean, for example, while there's this growing enthusiasm for a green economy, a sustainable energy transition and reconciliation, to put it bluntly, transitions to sustainable energy are likely going to perpetuate the existing colonial landscape in Canada, unless the energy sector, including the municipal, provincial, territorial, federal governments, the utilities, the regulators, developers, consultants, investments, brokers, researchers, educators, including not-for-profits and other key stakeholders and power mongers, begin the hard work of decolonizing themselves, their organizations, their epistemologies, and ultimately their relationship to land. And so I think that's where we can turn to Indigenous peoples for their ways of being and seeing the world, being a part of the world and not apart from it, that can really make a difference. And if I have another minute of time, if it's okay, Michael, just to say that, you know, our in Canada, when we think about decolonizing, again, I turn to Eve Tuck and Wayne Yang for what they talk about. It's not just a metaphor for, oh, let's do something to improve our societies. It's literally a call to bring about repatriation of Indigenous land and life. It's not, oh, let's decolonize this, let's decolonize that. It's, if we do it that way, if we just sort of make it a key term, a tokenized term, it just makes it possible for us to continue to move towards an innocence amongst the settler population that problematically reconciles settler guilt, complicity, and maintain like a settler future. If we don't address the status quo of our governance structures, which are rooted in European white supremacy, including our legal structures, we can't change who is disproportionately affected by pollution and climate change and who benefits and has greater access to power and the ability to influence change. We need to see that in Canada, the dominant worldview embraces capitalism and colonialism, and it's held sway since Confederation. So we really need to decolonize ourselves and repatriate Indigenous land and life literally. And finally, I would just say, you know, I really appreciated the enthusiasm of our sponsor, our key sponsor, about a green recovery, about electric vehicles being everywhere and access to everyone. But the reality is that is still perpetuating our capitalist demand for energy, our capitalist demand to consume energy, and the electrification that Chris mentioned at the beginning, that's been a focus of pollution probe. While I think it's great on the one hand, it doesn't challenge our way of thinking and being in the world. It doesn't challenge and say, we need to live differently in the world. And again, I think this is where we can engage with Indigenous ways of knowing that we call in English sustainability, but Indigenous ways of being in, and as we heard at the beginning, people in place for thousands of years knowing how to engage in sustainable lifestyles and thinking about the next generation. And I know that there was a slide that I was gonna put up about the United Nations Declaration. We can just put it in the chat box. As a reminder, there's some really obvious articles that people can turn to for inspiration and change the way we govern ourselves. It's not just about meaningful engagement, it's about co-governance, co-policy creation, not just a Western way of doing things. Thanks.
Very nice. Thank you very much. And I think one of the things that I picked up on is that the data, like in terms of the data, there is the First Nations governance. There's the OCAP program that you can look at through Algonquin College. If you want more reasoning or training in that sort of information set of why we Indigenous participation and ownership of the data is very important as you move forward. So that's there for us. Thank you, Heather. And I'm going to bring forward Anna G now. And if you could follow up a little bit more on those topics and policy as we go forward.
Yeah, or Heather can just take my time. That was great. I was just nodding the whole time. I think what I wanted to bring up is looping back to power and to really willingness to give up and change the way that we currently have our structure set up. And while I agree with Dr. Anna around the need for legislation and policy that is equitable and inclusive, I think there's still a number of issues with the way policy is currently made and who it serves and how it has been for as long as we know. So on that note, Youth Climate Lab, one of the shifts that we work on is policy. And we see it as a tool in a toolbox of opportunities to create change in climate, but not as the only tool. So it's part of it. And what we do is kind of twofold. The first part is demystification of policymaking, like how is it actually happening? Because it has been made to seem a lot more complex than it should be as a way of keeping people out, people that should be participating in those decisions. So that's kind of one of the things that we do. And the other one is ensure meaningful co-design, co-creation, and co-participation in those tables. While I was writing this out, and this is kind of how we speak about it, I think it's also worth noting that more of our recent conversations are, do we want to be at that table? Do we need a whole new table? Like, do we need to be breaking the table and start our own? Because this table is like pretty not great right now. So I think there's space for both. There's space to work from within structures, within system, and kind of disrupt from inside. And that's kind of what we're doing. We're just developing what we call an infiltration manual on how to understand governance systems at the municipal level to be able to access and push for climate action from within. But do we need to be creating new things and new approaches? I think because of the scale of the problem and the magnitude of the problem, we do. We cannot just assume that the same systems and the same solutions that we've been using so far is going to get us to where we need to be. So I just wanted to bring up quickly, I'm not taking time, so stop me at any moment, but an example of what we've done kind of on that sphere and where we learned a lot was Future Exchange, a program that was designed to connect and equip young people to create their own community projects. So again, always grounding it back to what is relevant to their community and to their needs. And it was really a first of its kind, as far as we know, in terms of grounding the capacity building exercise and the conversations and the projects in traditional knowledge and climate policy to help communities really engage in solutions for them, as I mentioned. We created it in partnership with the Wichin Tribal Council and the Vantat Wichin First Nation, and of the 15 youth that participating, half were Wichin and half were from Southern Canada. And it was building that in exchange again, or interconnectedness of different approach and how we could, this is a very capitalist term, but like use and utilize the tools that we have at our disposal to really be developing new solutions or solutions that might be different. So maybe I'll end with that. And hopefully that ties in some of the things that we've been talking about, but happy to answer any questions later on.
Yeah, 100%. And great segue on that. If you do have any questions, we're using the chat function right now. I can see the number going up in front of me, and I'm unfortunately can't read them all. But our panelists will be here to answer those questions and try and get those answers out to you if we don't get them covered within our session. So please feel free to ask the questions in the chat. But with that, Kerry Ann, can you follow up from what I would say the engagement side? How do we get the communities, let's talk from the First Nation perspective, how do we get that engagement to happen? How do we make it work and how do we make it go?
So first I want to start off by saying that I don't think that there's one simple way of saying that, as we are all our own communities, we're all our own nations that have our own priorities and core values, that sort of thing. But I think a big part of that is, you know, I actually had one of the elders that I'm privileged to be able to see at different meetings and other functions. Well, not this year, obviously. But one of the things that he had said to me was, when I asked that question, as someone in my position that has a voice, what do I do and how do I move this agenda forward? And what he said to me was, actually, you need to go sit in the bush and listen, because that is where our teachings come from. That when we look around us and as Indigenous people being connected to the environment, we need to be able to listen to those teachers around us. So with that being said, then in terms of the organizations, and that's one of the things I think why you changed my title at CIPS, is because of the engagement that I do with the non-Indigenous organizations in terms of trying to not necessarily educate them around our community and our community needs, but also trying to create those safe places that are needed for us to actually understand each other before we move forward. So a big part of that is listening to each other as well. We need to be able to, one, I mentioned the Truth and Reconciliation calls to action and the big apology that happened in, I believe it was 2016. But one of the often things that I hear is that with all this legislation and the support for Indigenous communities having their voices, is people don't understand the context of that. People don't understand the whys. People don't understand or know the true history of contact, of where Canada really, how Canada was really built. So I, again, with another elder that I've been able to have conversations with, is that upon contact, what we know as community and as Indigenous people of Turtle Island is we were a community. Although our nations didn't always get along together, we were a community with all of the beatings, with all of what sustains us. And upon contact, we ended up looking at our environment as a commodity. So we got to stop doing that. I don't know if I'm able to share a slide. I wasn't going to at first, but I think it's just important in terms of when we're looking at our communities and talking about engagement, that we come back to this. This is one of the things that I often fall back to now as an Indigenous woman who is in the environment field, having a voice, and who is actually also learning about what an Indigenous person of Turtle Island is and who I am as a person because of the colonization and the assimilation that's happened in the past and is actually still happening in this very present. And I think when engaging our communities, I think in any aspect, especially when we're talking about environment and inequity, is that if we don't collectively come together and start to talk about preserving and protecting our environment for future generations, everything else that we talk about in terms of equity is not going to happen. It's the environment that sustains us, and we all need to be able to connect to the environment that way, and then ask and listen and find those answers within. And you know, as an Indigenous person, these are values in which we are to be living our lives, so that we're living our lives in a sustainable way. And I think as organizations, if you ask yourself and you hold yourself to these seven grandfather teachings, that yeah, we will be able to find that common ground and be able to move forward in a really good way. I think I'll stop there.
Excellent, thank you very much. Again, as the facilitator, my apologies, I said chat, I should have said Q&A for those questions, if you have some of those questions under the Q&A. We were gonna have 1 minute, but if everyone wants to turn their cameras back on. Melissa, did you get any questions that you might wanna pose to the group through the session?
Hi, yeah, thank you, Michael. And good afternoon, everyone. My name is Melissa DeYoung, and I'm the Director of Policy and Programs with Pollution Probe. So just here to jump in with a couple of questions from the audience. And I did want to mention that you can continue to share your questions throughout the afternoon if you have them. We will continue to monitor them, and whatever we don't get to in the panels, we will make sure we try to carry over into the networking session this afternoon. And we can follow up with you as well if there are specific questions. So the first question that we wanted to ask was, I think for Anna and Kerry Ann. And the question is, I think, tied to a little bit what you were just discussing, Kerry Ann, and that is, what are some key steps that the environmental community can take or work together to take to ensure that equity becomes more of a fundamental element of sustainable development?
So again, I guess the first step is to do your due diligence and find out the history of the land that you're on, right? What is Canada's true history? What does truth and reconciliation mean? What does duty to consult mean? What does reconciling mean to you? And it's not just reconciling in regards to reconciling as people, but again, and it's been mentioned, I think, in different terms in throughout this panel, is reconciling with the land. We need to remember and understand that is in which sustains us all.
Great. And and Melissa, who else was that for? Sorry,
I think for Anna G as well.
Anna G,
okay. And anyone, I'm sure anyone can feel free to answer.
Absolutely.
I would echo that, and I think I want to bring up something that I personally struggle with, which is, when it gets too overwhelming, when I think of climate as an issue, I've been aware or like concerned since my slide in 2005 at the very least. And I think as it's a global problem, a global issue, what I find the most that brings me back and roots me back to why I'm doing what I'm doing is remembering exactly that, my connection to the land that I'm a guest on right now, the land that I'm from, and what can I do in my immediate community. But the tension that I see with that is that I would also like to remind everyone that climate knows no man-made borders, and we're seeing the effects of climate change beyond our communities here. A recent example, Nicaragua got hit by a second hurricane in 2 weeks when they're responsible for 0.02% of the global GHG emissions. So who experiences the consequences of climate change is not who creates it. And that's true at very different levels. So yeah, grounding ourselves in local needs and community needs and our responsibility as individuals, while also remembering that it goes way past us.
Brilliant, thank you. Melissa, we have a couple more minutes for another question. Do you have another one there for us?
Sure, we had another question come in which was related to the pandemic, something that I think has come up a couple times today, but what has been the impact of COVID-19 in compounding or highlighting some of the existing inequities that we see in Canada?
That's for me?
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Anna B. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So I actually am consulting for COVID for a lot of Northern Ontario. So clearly we're seeing disparities as far as COVID. Until recently, there wasn't a lot of COVID in the communities, but because the communities decided that that there was a threat to the elders, and so many communities locked down. And what that meant was that dentists, nurses, diabetic nurses, you know, all kinds of people were not coming into the community. So there was, you know, people weren't dying from COVID, they're dying from suicide, they're dying from heart attacks and diabetes not being under control. And so now, and the big thing what's happened in with COVID is the fear, because throughout, you know, hundreds of years, or more even recently, like with smallpox, measles, and you know, just Indigenous communities have been disproportionately impacted. But more recently with H1N1, when Manitoba asked for help, they were sent body bags. And even now, you know, I'm really disappointed after so many months of knowing about COVID, many communities don't have the adequate resources for rapid testing. They don't have places to isolate people when people get sick. And, you know, we've known about this. I started a petition with a former chief of Ontario, Isidore Day, to try to get more funding for Indigenous communities. And so we had, and they gave another $300 million, but the provincial governments in some places, like for example, Ontario, has basically given nothing. And so you have a lot of communities that feel like, okay, the barriers are starting to break. COVID is starting to come in. There's a lot of fatigue and you know, they're afraid that people are gonna start to die. And then when it does come into these Indigenous communities, it again, there's a disproportionate death rate because of the underlying conditions and overcrowding and a whole bunch of risk factors.
Great, thank you. That's a great question. We're sort of getting to our end of our time here. What I'd like to do is closing remarks once around. Heather, since we didn't hear from you on those Q&As, Heather, I'll let you go first on a simple, you know, 30-second, 1-minute closing remarks as we wrap it up.
Sure, thank you. I guess for me, a key message that I'd want to leave people with is just about the structures that we need to address, and that these are European colonial structures, and that applies to why there's overcrowded housing in northern communities, for example. It's not, you know, there's reasons for why this is taking place, and that's where we need to do the work. And that employing non-Western knowledge systems to think about our relationship to land, water, and the air, to non-human living entities, to more than human entities too, really needs to be a major shift in the way we think about the world and our place in it, not apart from it, not controlling it. And that that in addition to, I guess, law, colonial law, there's also the natural laws that we can attend to that can help give us guidance, I think, on how to be in a better relationship with the world. And with the land around us, and to do our part to take care of the land that we're on, whether we're there as uninvited guests or the original peoples of that place. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather. Thank you for your participation today. It's great. Anna G, why don't we go to you for a closing remark? And it sounds like such a rock star name, Anna G and Anna B. So Anna G.
Thanks. I'll be very brief. I think I just want to leave by saying I'm assuming the majority of our audience right now is in the environmental sector, as we saw from the earlier polls. There's a lot that we need to learn, and even more than we need to unlearn, about the way that we do things in this space. We cannot be doing climate work without considering climate justice and climate equity and the underlying factors that are just exacerbating how people experience climate change and how people experience other factors like COVID. I think one of my biggest peeves during COVID was people saying it was a greatest equalizer. It was not. People experienced it incredibly differently based on the level of privilege that they brought. So yeah, I would challenge everyone that's listening to hopefully sit with the discomfort that comes with having to unlearn and recognize that the way that we've done things is not probably, it's not the best way to move forward, and that we need to be addressing that as people with positions of power right now.
Very good. Thank you, Kerry Ann. Would you like to do a couple closing remarks?
Sure, yeah. I want to say thank you for the opportunity first. And I want to echo what everybody has said here on the panel. But one of the things I guess that I'd like to leave you with is that one, we're all people, we're all here. We all have gifts that we were given by the Creator to give. The Indigenous people are a kind people. We're not a scary people. We don't want to, throw wrenches into development or other people's prosperities or anything like that. What we need to happen is for people to do their due diligence about where they are, whose land that they are privileged to be on. and then be able to acknowledge that so that we understand where we've come from and how we got here today, so that we can move forward together in a good way with those gifts that we've been given by the Creator. As well as, I just want to echo Heather's point that she made about data and the amount of data that we have, and we need to start turning that into actions. Another one of my elders, actually from Akwesasne, Elmer Lickers, I was privileged to attend a conference that he was keynote at this time last year. And one of the things that he really expressed was that we've got all of this data, we've got all of these awesome experts. And I guess that's sort of where people like myself come in, who is not academic. I've actually learned all of everything that I do from actually doing it and experiencing it. So I'm actually a communicator and a disseminator. And that's what we need right now, to bring those two worldviews together so that we can move forward in a good way, especially in this time of environmental crisis. So
I'll be. Excellent. Thank you, Kerry Ann. And Dr. Anna B., if you could finish up with us, and don't be afraid to plug your conference one more time at the end, that would be great.
Okay, well, again, thank you. And I thank you for all the words of wisdom that all of you have. And I think that if we start listening and start understanding that for many of us, what we think is the truth is really not the truth. And if we start looking at the history of what happened to Indigenous peoples in the land that you're at, you're in locally, or even more regionally, or in all of Canada, you understand that what we were told is not the truth. And if we can start listening to Indigenous peoples, they have so much knowledge about the land and the environment, the youth, the elders. There's so much learning that we can do. And I think in some ways we don't have a choice. I think with the environment and the way things are moving, I think the smartest thing for us to move forward is really to listen to, the people with the knowledge, which are, the indigenous communities, but also the people who will be leading us out of this path, which is the youth. So thank you very much. As I mentioned, I co-chair the Indigenous Health Conference. Even though it's a health conference, it really is about the determinants of health. And so we talk about water and environmental issues as well, food security. And our theme this year is the youth. Youth as leaders, but also suicide prevention. And so if you're interested in learning more about the conference, I left the link into the chat box, but also you just Google Indigenous Health Conference and you'll find it. Thank you again for the opportunity.
Excellent. Thank you very much, everyone. I want to bring us back to, the theme was inequity and how the inequity is real. And for us to continue the way we're going is going to be painful. I'm going to go right off script here in terms of I teach my daughter how to play hockey and her friends how to play hockey as a hockey coach, and I'll make it really Canadian here. But one of the things that we teach when we're teaching them to skate is you fall down, right? It's the learning part is the painful part. When you actually learn to skate, that's when you start to smile. That's when you start to really accomplish things. And that's when you might score your goal. But that learning part, while we're figuring something out, you're going to make mistakes and you're going to have these hurdles to come over. So, from the simple things that we do in life, it's the learning. And I think what Kerry Ann had said, that, we need these information people to provide us, to help us get through this learning aspect of this new, not new, the place where we all believe we should be, I think is a great place. I want to thank Melissa as well for inviting me to this panel. We are getting ready to wrap up. Melissa, I'm going to ask you to join as well and to wrap up the session and move us on and transition through the Q&A as well as the chat and how people can get in touch with our great panelists. I really appreciate it. It was great to meet you over the last 4 days and get to know you, and your perspectives are excellent. I appreciate that. And over to you, Melissa.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Michael. And on behalf of Pollution Probe, I just wanted to close out the panel by saying another big thank you to all of our panelists, Anna B., Heather, Anna G., and Kerry Ann. I think it's been a fantastic panel. I know I'm taking a lot away from what you've shared here today. Thank you for your knowledge and sharing your insights with us, and for engaging in what I think has been not only an important, but also a very fruitful discussion. Also, of course, a very big thank you to Michael as well for guiding the discussion and for your excellent moderation throughout the course of the panel. We really appreciate all of you being here with us today. So thank you so much again. We are going to take about a 6-minute break at this point so everyone can get up and stretch their legs and sort of recharge before we reconvene at 2:30. And that will be for the start of panel 2, which is looking at equitable participation in climate change solutions. So thank you again, everyone, for the panel 1. And we look forward to seeing everyone back here in just a few minutes. Thanks.
And panelists, if you can scroll through the chat and the Q&A just while there are people are on break, maybe there's some people that would like to follow up with you. Maybe put your email in the chat as well if you want people to get in touch with you, or your website, something along those lines. That would be fantastic. Thank you, Melissa. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks so much.